Throughout history, millions of people have been misdiagnosed and mistreated by physicians. Not necessarily because of wrongdoing, but because doctors simply didn't know any better. Epileptics were beaten. The mentally ill were considered incurable, hence not a medical responsibility. Many languished in prisons and cages. Infusions of lamb's blood were once state-of-the-art in medicine. Surgeons were offended when Joseph Lister asked them to wash their hands and disinfect the operating area. Even Louis Pasteur, father of the science of microbiology, was the center of controversy when he announced that disease is caused by tiny organisms invisible to the human eye. These examples remind us that medicine is an evolving science. New discoveries challenge existing beliefs. But in the meantime, for people suffering from a new or misunderstood disease, life can be a living hell.
I just cannot get rid of this flu, and it keeps getting worse, not better.
But it's been months now. Maybe it's not the flu. Flu doesn't last that long.
You ought to go back to Dr. Raymond.
I did, Blanche. He said I'm fine.
Get a second opinion.
She did. She went to Dr. Schlesinger.
Well, then, you are fine. Now, you want to hear my idea?
She is not fine, Blanche. Look at her.
I didn't say she looks fine. I said she was fine. She looks like hell.
That scene was from the 1989 season premiere of The Golden Girls. The mysterious disease that struck Dorothy is chronic fatigue immune dysfunction syndrome, CFIDS, or SFIDS, a disease that today disables thousands, perhaps millions, of Americans. You may never have heard of it, or you may not have taken it seriously. After all, many doctors don't believe it exists. So first, let's get this straight. SFIDS is a real disease. It's a serious disease. It has been recognized as such by the United States Department of Health and Human Services since 1988.
I think all of us agree, one, that there is a problem. There's an illness called chronic fatigue syndrome. And while that sounds obvious, you know, for a long time, the syndrome has been highly controversial among medical circles as to whether it exists or it does not exist.
SFIDS may be the most widespread, fastest-moving chronic disease to have emerged in the world in this century. No one can predict when, how, or who SFIDS will strike next. In 1984, SFIDS struck the resort community of Incline Village, Nevada. Almost 300 people in the Lake Tahoe area came down with a mysterious malady which the media would dub the yuppie flu.
I remember seeing a patient who had been a former marathon runner and had come back from China and said she'd developed some illness in China and absolutely could do nothing after she'd come back. And I thought this was kind of a trivial viral illness, but she never got better. At about the same time, a whole bunch of patients from the community, from the girls, the basketball team, and some teachers from the Truckee High School, developed very similar complaints.
The patients complained of fever, weakness, headaches, swollen glands, difficulty concentrating, and most of all, fatigue which no amount of bed rest could cure. At first, patients thought they had the flu, but it never went away.
They kept accelerating to the point that I guess by the midsummer, July or so of 1985, we had almost 200 cases.
I initially called the CDC because this is what they're supposed to solve, these unusual kinds of diseases, and asked for some help.
In September 1985, CDC epidemiologists finally arrived in Incline Village. The focus of their investigation was to determine if Epstein-Barr virus could be the cause of the strange epidemic.
As we were seeing some of these patients, we brought them into the room to show them, here, feel this spleen, or here, feel this node, or this is a patient. They didn't really, in my view, like seeing a lot of these people. They preferred to stay down in an office poring over charts. And there was a high degree of skepticism on both of their parts. And then after 2 weeks of collecting chart data and serologies, they went back to the CDC. And months went by, and we never heard anything from them.
When word spread to the media, Cheney and Peterson found themselves the target of angry business leaders who feared news of the epidemic would hurt tourism.
I ran into doctors that said that very thing, that I was bad for tourism, that didn't I know that the only way Tahoe City was ever going to survive was with tourists, and that I shouldn't tell anybody.
Shunned and harassed, the doctors fought a lonely battle. Peterson's car was sprayed with graffiti. Restaurants refused to serve them. And a group of mothers asked that Peterson's child be removed from nursery school. While doctors Cheney and Peterson persevered without help in Nevada, a similar mystery disease struck in the small rural town of Lindenville, New York. Here, it was mostly children who became ill with the non-stop flu.
The group in Lindenville comprises 230 people who developed this pattern of symptoms. About half of them had it to the severity where you could say that they met the CDC criteria, with a 50% reduction of activity for at least 6 months. The other half had it in a milder form. We did notify the New York State Department of Health, and we mentioned to them that we had a cluster outbreak of an unusual illness that we thought might be related to raw milk or some type of infectious agent that we were unable to identify. One person did come from New York State Department of Health, and after about 20 minutes or so, that person left the office, and I thought he went out for a lunch break, and I never heard from them again.
Many of those Incline Village and Lindenville patients are still sick. But SIFIDS does not attack only in clusters. All across the country, SIFIDS has stricken individuals apparently at random, and often in the prime of life.
Tracy was a very intelligent, canny, caring, loving girl. She had a wonderful sense of humor. She had the best pitching arm on the block. She was better than any of the boys. She was good. She was athletic, an honors graduate at Santa Barbara, and wanted to help kids in trouble, and was halfway through a master's degree in special education when she died. Tracy came down with a case of flu and never recovered. Between April of 1988 and the end of 1989, she was sick for 115 working days. Tracy was always a fighter, and she thought she was going to get better. She'd always gotten over everything else, but the girl who biked 25 miles a day had to rest on every second step to climb a flight of stairs. She had eye pain, migraines, backache, and difficulty in breathing, which was really frightening. The pain was all over her body, 24 hours a day. I have a list of 4 pages of doctor's appointments. We went to private doctors, and we also went to the group that she belonged to. She was treated badly in most places by most doctors. It didn't matter whether they're private or not, except the private ones cost more. Tracy was told it was all in her head. She wasn't sick. She should go to see a psychiatrist. And that was one of the things that bothered my daughter very much. She was a proud girl. It got worse and worse. She hurt more and more.
Hi, it's Tracy.
Hi, Tracy.
Hi.
You're taking a lot more Dilaudid now.
Well, what happened was I ran out of Vicodin ES, and so I decided I would just take the Dilaudid till it ran out.
Tracy, your official dose is 1 3 times a day. If you exceed that dose, day, the pharmacy calls us, the nurses, I mean, it sets off all sorts of alarms, and then they start looking at you like you're, you know, selling drugs on the street. So I know you're not, okay? But if you and I decide on a given dosage for a, you know, a certain prescription, you have to stick with it or let us know in advance that you're changing it.
We've always wondered why you write the lowest dose. Well, you know, why aren't you writing the biggest, the dose that I'm taking?
Yeah, the reason that I'm writing the lowest possible dose is because of the problems that we run into from the pharmacist regarding the amount of pain medications that are going toward you. Every time we have a prescription go through, they frequently call us and they say, are you sure? Is this real? Because they don't usually, it's very rare that they get pain prescriptions of this magnitude.
Well, I don't know what the hell to say, because I'm in pain, and there's nothing, I can't do anything about it. I don't know what to say.
Well,
I can't do 3 a day. Forget it. I can do 10 a day and live and still be miserable and be unable to watch TV because my eyes hurt and my back hurts and my legs hurt. I will not make it through this weekend if I'm this sick and in this much pain. It's impossible to make it through.
For someone like her, life really becomes a chore to just from moment to moment. She is really spending most of her time trying to accommodate her pain. And the lifestyle that someone like this has is terrible because their whole life is devoted to living with this illness. And for them, this illness is no less than just about any other illness that I can think of, including AIDS and cancer and most any other illness. The severe pain and debilitation that they have is really profound. I think that Tracy was despondent and frustrated by the severe symptoms that she was having from the disease and also by the lack of what she considered quality help from the medical profession. And I was Tracy's doctor, and I would include myself in that. I was not able to see and respond to the amount of pain and frustration that she was having.
I don't blame her. She fought for 3.5 years with incredible courage to try to get well. She got worse and worse. She finally just gave up. This is Tracy's suicide letter to her private doctor. Here I sit amongst OTC drugs, prescription drugs, plastic bags. My life is bags and drugs, bags and drugs. Every day, I hung on the edge. Maybe today will be tolerable. That's all I asked for. Maybe I'll be able to tolerate it all today. Again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and again. Barely hanging on, hoping only for comfort today, this hour, this half hour. Please, God, take the pain away, just for a while, just for the next 15 minutes, just for an hour. Why is that so much to ask?
A little girl was in our group, committed suicide, and I asked Dr. what killed her? Excuse me. What killed her? He said, she killed herself. I said, you son of a bitch. Excuse me, we're framing. I said, she died of the disease.
Jim Haw came down with SIFIDS 8 years ago. He lives with his wife and two sons outside Reno, Nevada. Unlike Tracy, who suffered with intractable pain, Jim's most disabling symptom is severe cognitive dysfunction.
I was a workaholic, well-educated.
Involved in real estate.
I was involved in real estate. I bought this 3,800 acres out here. I built 400 homes. I was very involved. I was involved in all the counselors and the regents and all the people in town, very politically. And I got sick. For 2 years, I lay in bed 22 hours a day.
Like so many other SIFID's patients, Jim got little support from his doctor.
He was a schmuck. I knew I had something terribly wrong, and I went in for a biopsy. He said, "You're too young to have liver problems. And it's all in your head anyway. And you're overweight.
And you're lazy.
And you're lazy."
I had Jimmy at home on IVs for about a year.
I was furious that this man did not give me the credibility of being someone in the committee. You know, I'm director of YMCA. I was till I got sick. I mean, you know.
It took us, we had to go through about two or three doctors until we were able to find one that understood.
But there was little the doctor could do. Jim's condition deteriorated.
I started not being able to speak right. And I have always had a silver tongue. And keep me on the spot.
You were always able to speak right. And then when you became sick, you started having trouble with
Then I got an MRI.
MRI.
And they said you've got punctate lesions in the forefront of your brain, which causes
speech problems
in
walking problems, balance.
Memory. So I remember every nickel that happened 20 years ago. I remember everybody. But I wouldn't remember your name, and I didn't even remember when I came to see you last.
Very little short-term memory.
No, almost none.
This afternoon, Jimmy will go lay down and take a nap, and he'll wake up, and he won't even remember that this happened. He may have seizures all afternoon, and he won't remember that that happened. And he doesn't realize a lot of times that he's sick. Everybody says you should live one day at a time, but when you get into a situation like this, you do live one day at a time. One day Jimmy may wake up and that day he can't speak, or that day he can't walk. I take him out when he's doing good, and when he's not doing good, I protect him.
The depression is so bad. I've put one of my guns to my head and pulled the trigger for hours. It wasn't loaded. I just wanted to see if I could do it. And then I decided that I couldn't abandon my children because they would say Daddy killed himself, and I can't do that to my children.
I'm fortunate that I am a nurse and that I can take care of Jim, or else he would require nursing care.
My life is hell. If there's a heaven there, life in hell is right here. Hell. I'm living in hell.
Most people with SIFIDs are not as sick as Tracy or Jim. For many people, the symptoms wax and wane and may even go into remission for days, months, or years. But at the slightest exertion or stress, or apparently without provocation at all, they may again fall seriously ill.
Chronic fatigue and chronic fatigue syndrome are two different things. Chronic fatigue is a symptom that occurs in virtually every illness. Chronic fatigue syndrome is a cluster of many, many symptoms, and it is a disease. It's not being tired at the end of the day.
And there's no way rest will make you not tired. You'll still be tired when you wake up.
I wouldn't know when the curtain would close on my day, you know, whether it was going to be 10 a.m., 11 a.m., 2 p.m.
But it got a little bit scary because I wasn't able to physically take care of myself anymore.
I was in a bed for a year, wheelchair, and the whole bit.
However mild or severe their symptoms, SIFID's patients share the experience of countless visits to doctors, endless tests, mounting costs, and few answers.
I have now lost all of my peripheral vision. I am also losing my frontal vision.
I've got aortic and mitral valve prolapses in the heart. I've got epileptic-like seizure disorder. I have inflammation of the interior of the veins. And I have lesions on the brain. And still, with all of this, my chart is riddled with the words somatic and psychiatric.
But it's hard to understand actual doctors that you go to that have no idea about it and don't know what to do about it and tell you it's all in your head and there's really nothing wrong with you.
Dorothy, get dressed. You're fine.
I beg your pardon?
We've run every test known to man. They're all normal. You can get dressed, go home, enjoy your life.
But Dr. Stevens, I was always healthy and then I came down with this flu. I can't get rid of it. I've been sick for 5 months now. I have a constant sore throat, swollen glands, fevers. My muscles ache and are weak. I am totally exhausted all the time.
I know. You told me.
Well, maybe it bears repeating.
And at a certain point when you've shown up negative on enough tests, suddenly the demeanor towards you changes. Suddenly you're not a gravely ill patient who they are worried is about to die. Suddenly you're a problem patient.
Look, Dorothy, can I ask you a personal question?
Yes.
You're divorced.
Yes.
How's your social life? Do you see men?
What in the world does seeing men have to do with anything?
Well, Dorothy, we know for a fact that if people are not happy, and lonely people aren't, but they get all kinds of symptoms.
And as they're unable to get a resolution of a positive result to a test they were expecting to be positive, then they displace their frustration towards a patient.
They told me at that time I was suffering from a bad attitude. And I kept trying to tell them it wasn't a bad attitude. I passed a bad attitude about 5 years ago.
The doctors, when I started having these seizures, they'd make a call on me that I was a drug addict or an alcoholic.
And one doctor said to me when I complained of a swollen gland under my arm, he said, well, you know, maybe your bra's a little too tight. Not thinking that in 34 years I might have been able to figure that out myself. I bought all the clippings in and said, gee, these sound like me. Oh, I have all of these symptoms. And they said, I don't believe this exists.
This is my son, Kalen. Both of us have CFIDs. He had severe headaches and severe abdominal pains. And his pediatrician finally said, I think he may be having some school phobia problems.
I mean, poor chronic fatigue patients have been treated shabbily, you have to say that. They've been shunted from doctor's office to doctor's office, being told everything's in their head.
Like the same thing with my teachers. I would look fine, so they would really think that I was not sick.
People don't believe them. This is the cause of the greatest long-term damage that this illness causes, especially in children.
All in all, I've seen 212 physicians. 210 of them did not believe me. Two did. 210 told me I was crazy, and I never gave up.
If anyone found themselves kidnapped, trapped in a room, drugged, and put in a bed and left in a room for 5 years, that they would have media attention that was phenomenal. Everyone in the world would be screaming for their release, and there are so many people who live in this situation.
How many Americans are held hostage by SIFIDs? Estimates range from 100,000 to 5 million. Since 1985, the CDC has been conducting a surveillance survey, but after 8 years, has made no report. So no one really knows. Many experts believe SIFIDS is not new. It's just gone by different names. Today, SIFIDS is called myalgic encephalomyelitis in England and low natural killer cell disease in Japan. Many experts believe there may have been over 60 SIFIDS epidemics in this century alone. But others think SIFIDS is a new disease, or that it suddenly has become more widespread since the early 1980s. But no one really knows. Some experts estimate up to 80% of people with SIFIDS are women. Again, no one knows.
I see an incredibly wide variety of patients. with syphilis. A wide age group. I've seen people as young as 5 years old with suspicion of syphilis. I see people well into their 60s with syphilis.
We did a training at San Francisco General Hospital, which is a county hospital and treats a lot of poor people. Their intake nurses and nurse practitioners thought that all people with syphilis were poor people, people of color, because that's who they were seeing.
I've been in support group about 6 to 7 years now, and I've been the only black, and I've been very curious about that.
You know, as far as a lot of minorities are concerned, especially minorities of lower incomes, aren't going to continue to see different doctors until they find somebody who will diagnose them adequately.
However diverse its victims, syphilis can devastate their lives.
I was teaching classical ballet, and I was extremely active. I had my own dance company, and I was a glamorous, happy, outgoing, cheerful person. I had absolutely no reason to want to stay in bed for 5 years, which is what happened to me.
Is that me? I've written a lot of award-winning poetry, and I have trouble writing, spelling correctly now. Oftentimes my own name on a check. I'll sign N-A-R-Y, Nary, for Nancy. How can I write?
I was very athletic. I was a runner. I was a long-distance runner. I ran half marathons and races. And I'd always been healthy.
I've got 5 pairs of skis sitting in my closet and at home, and hockey gear and windsurfing sails and mountain bikes just sitting there. You know, I don't want to sell them because I'm going to get better. Get better or die trying.
What happened to my dancing? How about what happened to my walking?
Everything's different now. I'm a disabled person. I was a healthy person.
People with syphilis aren't the only ones affected. Syphilis is hard on the entire family.
Kim's husband is very supportive, but he is carrying around a rage you just cannot believe. And when it surfaces, he just explodes. This is very common with syphilis.
So often we see people with this disease, typically women, who are cast aside by their husbands, even by their parents. And they end up totally isolated because nobody believes they're really sick.
As if loss of health, job, family, and friends weren't enough, there is the enormous cost of this disease.
I'm barely skimping by. I lost my house, I lost my job, I lost my self-esteem.
I lost my legal practice. I had to file bankruptcy and lost my automobile and all of my assets during the bankruptcy.
I ended up, when the warm weather, I ended up living in my little car with my dog.
I have lost everything I've worked for my whole life. I have spent the last 6 years being housebound. I no longer grocery shop. I no longer do laundry. I no longer pay bills. I'm not a functioning human being.
I know from personal experience that this is a devastating disease. There is nothing that you cherish that this disease cannot take away from you. Absolutely nothing. Your career, your identity, your reason for living.
How can it be that so many Americans must suffer so greatly? How, in this information age, is it possible that not only the average American citizen, but the average American doctor knows so little about a disease that some experts call the AIDS of the 90s. Syphilis advocates blame the name given the disease by the Centers for Disease Control and the National Institutes for Health.
Sometimes, you know, I want to call it chronic fear syndrome instead of chronic fatigue, because chronic fatigue sounds like, just take me to Oprah and give me the bonbons, and the illness is not like that at all.
The name that this disease has been given in this country is trivializing.
We have a joke amongst the syphilis community, both patients and providers, I think, that we need to get the F word out of the chronic fatigue immune dysfunction syndrome. the F word is a little bit like describing diabetes as the chronic peeing disease. Of course, people who have diabetes pee a lot, but the disease covers so much more and includes so many other symptoms that it really does not do the disease justice. The same is true for chronic fatigue syndrome.
And that has greatly hampered our efforts to be taken seriously by anybody, the media, our families, the press, the medical profession.
But the name is only part of the problem. SIFIDS has a history of halting recognition by the medical establishment. The American Medical Association has made equivocal statements at best. And research at the National Institutes for Health has concentrated on proving SIFIDS to be a psychoneurotic ailment. The leading SIFIDS investigator at NIH, Stephen Strauss, refused to be interviewed. Only recently has the NIH acknowledged the immune abnormalities present in SIFIDS patients. Consequently, few doctors are adequately prepared to recognize or treat SIFIDS patients.
And I was on the guilty side of mistreating a number of patients. I'd see a patient who I thought there was something wrong, and I did a good workup, and it was all benign. And then I was faced with a dilemma. I had to confess to the patient that I had no idea of what was going on, and that's very uncomfortable to do. Moreover, I'm afraid maybe I'll get sued. If I'm missing a cancer, I'm going to get sued.
SIFIDS patients represent, in a sense, kind of the physician's worst nightmare, because diseases such as multiple sclerosis, lupus, Lyme disease, these diseases are all things that sit in the back of my mind, and I'm always wondering, is this a case of multiple sclerosis that looks like a case of SIFIDS that I am misdiagnosing?
Faced with the enormous costs of medical care, SIFIDS patients have turned to their insurance companies for help.
There are numerous problems involving medical insurance for people with SIFIDS. On the one hand, if a person applies for health insurance at a time that he or she has already been diagnosed with SIFIDS, the insurance company won't issue the policy. On the other hand, if the person comes down with SIFIDS after he or she's taken out the policy, but during a waiting period, the insurance company will say, you had a pre-existing condition which we won't insure. Or the insurance company will suggest, you don't have a pre-existing condition, but all of the medical treatments that you've suggested you want paid for are experimental, and we don't cover experimental treatments. In addition, they have trouble getting Social Security disability or SSI disability and Medicaid and Medicare. If they can't get those, or the funding of those is inadequate, or don't pay for the treatments they need, then they can easily become homeless. They can't pay their rent, they're out on the street.
SIFIDS advocates say they are confronting a frightening reality. Our present-day health systems can't afford another AIDS.
I think there's a huge investment now in this country to not want to know there's another epidemic, because it's very possible that the progress of AIDS alone will sink the public health establishment in the country.
All of the systems in medical care are set up for people either getting well or dying. For example, doctors, they don't want to see chronically ill people. They can't do anything for them. They come back, they get sick again. They come back, they get sick again. They can't cure them.
In the case of a chronic disease, such as CFIDS, we have children who get this disease and people in their 20s. And if it goes on, I've had the disease 13 years.
The message to government regulators and business people is there'll be a lot of downtime of people not being able to report to work, therefore putting companies at risk. It's like the AIDS epidemic and everything else. When you have somebody trained for 20, 30 years to do a job and they can't perform this job, that's bad for the individual and it's bad for the environment they work in. So I think it's going to have a major toll.
The most important thing is to communicate that at NIH there is a commitment to find answers about this illness, and very serious work is going on. It's steadily increased from less than $500,000 in 1986 to more than $3 million in 1992.
I don't think a $3 million contribution from the NIH this year is a sincere commitment to a disease that's affecting 100,000 to a million people.
While the government has been slow to respond, SIFIDS patients have not taken their illness lying down. In the early 1980s, they began to organize.
The Ziffitz Foundation started when a group of my friends got together about 6 years ago and put on a little fundraiser in a living room and raised $1,000.
Since 1986, the Chronic Fatigue Immune Dysfunction Syndrome Foundation in San Francisco has been helping people with SIFIDS. In addition to public education and policy development, the foundation offers telephone counseling and physician referrals to patients and their families. For many people with SIFIDS, the hotline provides the first understanding and support they have received since becoming ill.
No, you just want to feel better. You just want to feel like you can live, right?
Across the country in Charlotte, North Carolina, a former banker established the National SIFIDS Association.
The SIFIDS Association was really born out of desperation. Many patients, such as myself, went many, many years undiagnosed. We decided that what we needed to do was establish legitimacy by funding research. This is a true grassroots effort. The people who have this disease have absolutely nothing in common but the disease. And all of us were at some point in time, at least in the early days, we were rejected by the medical profession. So we banded together, and it occurred all over the country. It's amazing. These support groups just popped up, and you know, there were hundreds of them 5 years ago, and there's 1,000 of them today.
One obvious target for support has been celebrities, including many who suffer from SIFIDS.
My experience with celebrities who have this disease is primarily, not all of them, but with the majority, is that they're very unwilling to come forward because they're afraid of what it might do to their career.
I know a large number of people now that I didn't know before who had it, and they too kept it a secret. Lawyers, you know, a lot of my friends are in politics, you know, people with very serious careers who could not in any way show this weakness.
If somebody has $200 million, if they don't come up with at least $100,000 or $200,000 a year, I think they're nuts. It's not that I don't think they're socially irresponsible. That's a completely different issue. Certainly they're completely and totally socially irresponsible. But if you have money and you're not funding research, you're stupid. You're basically dumb.
On October 12, 1992, people with SIFIDS held a rally for the first time at the International Biotechnology Exposition in San Francisco.
When I got down here, I saw the sign on the wall, the banner that says, "In memory of Jean Hardy." She's a SIFIDS patient from North Carolina. She was featured on a CNN story, and she talked in that story about thinking about committing suicide because there was just no hope.
I can't wait to go to sleep at night so I can forget the pain.
And now it's become real. Just how long is it going to take before this whole street is full of black and white signs that say, "In memory of"?
Why are you wearing photographs on your blouse?
This is my son, because he wants me to remember him. And the reason that I hang on, even though it's hard, is because I want to be around for him. I want to see him get married. I want to see him go to school. And there's a lot of times that I don't feel like I'm going to be able to do it.
But why does he think you might not remember him?
I guess because I forget a lot of things once in a while.
What are you doing here with the camera?
Oh, I wanted to take it back and share it with the rest of our support group. There's too many that are too sick to come.
I have one who couldn't come because she couldn't even bring her reclining wheelchair to be here. People are just too ill to attend. We've tried letter writing campaigns. They're too ill to write letters.
How many more people are sick, do you think, than are able to come today?
Oh, hundreds, hundreds.
Why are you sitting? You look like it's just a nice day in the park.
I don't feel well enough to be standing up.
I'd like to stop hearing doctors say, "If I believed in CFIDS, then we could do so-and-so." It's not a situation of believing in CFIDS. This is not the tooth fairy. It's not Christmas. CFIDS is a disease.
Well, I think that that's very possible, that the kind of adversarial approach may have affected the desire, the willingness of many people to get involved in this field. I think there's no question about that.
support groups that have formed around SIFFIDS have done more for bringing attention to this disease and to bring some support, although most of it private, to those of us who are researchers trying to define this and find a solution in therapy. They've rallied companies to take it seriously. And they've rallied politicians to recognize that this is a major issue.
They got the language of chronic fatigue into the budget hearings the last 2 years, and that was a real accomplishment.
Without that attention, we wouldn't be seeing any focus on this disease in the 1990s. Absolutely not.
In the fall of 1992, an international SIFFIDS clinical research conference was held in Albany, New York. Organized by patient groups, the conference was attended by leading scientists from around the world. Finally, SIFFIDS was gaining legitimacy in medical circles.
Physicians are, or researchers are, studying certain areas which are on the cutting edge of medical science. And chronic fatigue syndrome comes to embody many of these.
We're working on understanding the immune system. We're working on understanding what cytokines do in autoimmune disease, in cancer, in AIDS, in many different disorders. So what we can do in advancing this understanding in terms of a disease like SIFFIDS will have wide ramifications to diseases in general and to understanding how we can manipulate the immune system to help us instead of hurt us.
I think there are three areas of research right now that seem to be most promising. One is research into infectious agents that may play a role in this illness. None have yet been conclusively shown to be a cause of this illness, but it's possible. Second, immune system changes that may be playing a role in this illness. There are several already that have been identified, and there may be more to be discovered. And a third very exciting area is changes in brain hormones or brain chemicals that could influence the immune system, could influence viruses that are already in the body. And these are areas where there's already a lot of research that's underway.
The most pressing question is, what is the cause of SIFFIDS?
Well, that's the $64,000 question. No one knows what the cause of this condition is. And there's a lot of controversy about it.
And it's analogous to the first meetings again with HIV that we had in 1983, where the ecologists were saying it's toxins in the air, and the Epstein-Barr people were saying it's Epstein-Barr, and the fungus people were saying it was fungus. I mean, all these same arguments aired in 1983 when there was another new and mysterious illness floating around. The point is, there's still a lot of research to do, and people have to perceive this illness first, as real, which has been a struggle. Second, as complicated and deserving a very in-depth and careful approach that's going to take years to accomplish.
Another question that especially worries patients and people close to them is SIFFIDS contagious?
And people with SIFFIDS do have terror about it. They think, should I be around this baby? Should I be around this family? Am I Typhoid Mary? Is everyone going to catch this disease from me?
The disease is not contagious. That we think the agent that causes disease is everywhere. And many people have already been infected, and they don't show any signs of the disease. It depends on the genetic makeup of the individual or where their immune system is at the time that the agent enters.
So I don't see any real reason to be telling people you can't be around people with chronic fatigue or chronic fatigue people. No, you can't be around society. The bigger risk is actually to the chronic fatigue patient from the infections that society carries, their colds and the flus.
Despite what the experts say, SIFFIDS advocates aren't so sure.
This is probably an infectious disease. We know that because we've seen whole towns full of people come down with it. We've seen families come down with it. We've seen groups of people in the workforce come down with it. Now, what we always say is the majority of people with SIFFIDS aren't around other people who have it, which means that on some level, everybody's not getting it. Maybe everybody's getting it and they're not symptomatic. But what we know is somehow it's passing through the population.
So what is known about SIFFIDS? Very little. Researchers have observed both immune system overactivation and under-response, endocrine abnormalities, and viral activity. With so little known, what can be done for the SFIDS patient.
It's very important that chronic fatigue syndrome patients or people who think they have chronic fatigue syndrome not try to self-diagnose this illness, because there are lots of other known medical illnesses which may be treatable if caught in time, which can start off with just plain fatigue for a while or with symptoms like CFS.
First thing is to diagnose, because when someone's going in to their doctor's office with all these symptoms, they have the most god-awful thoughts in the back of their mind.
I know in my case, one of the happiest days of my life, in fact, the happiest day except for the birth of my children, was the day I was told I had an incurable illness, this disease, because I didn't know what was the matter with me.
But diagnosis is no simple matter.
SFIDS patients are very difficult, amongst other reasons, because they look so good. You have someone who you hear is unemployed for 3 months on disability, who can't get out of bed. They come into your office, and you come in to see them, and they look normal. When you do your physical examination, there are a minimal amount of changes that you can see on the physical examination. When you proceed to the laboratory, the same is true. There are very few things that you can see on the laboratory. A routine blood count will probably be normal. Routine chemistries, probably be normal. Thyroid tests, probably normal. There is no diagnostic blood test or imaging test available that says you have or do not have the disease. Such a test does not exist.
Nor is there a known cure. The best patients can hope for now is relief of symptoms, such as pain, weakness, depression, sleep disturbance. Some treatments aim to intervene in the disease process, using immune modulators or antiviral drugs, such as gamma globulin and acyclovir. And many patients try to strengthen their overall resistance through nutritional supplements, getting plenty of rest, and simplifying their lifestyle. Dissatisfied with the care they have received from Western medicine, many SFIDS patients have turned to non-traditional alternatives.
Many people who have this disease are so sick and so desperate, they sort of end up saying, I will do anything. I will eat, you know, swamp grass if it'll make me feel better.
You find yourself going to alternative doctors, seeking alternative medicine, because a lot of people in a standard medicine are not terribly sympathetic. My doctor was sympathetic, but he did not have a lot to offer me.
It must be crazy for somebody to see all of these pills and to think that somebody actually takes these things almost on a daily basis. But if your back is against the wall and you have a very serious illness, you're willing to experiment with just about anything. And that's what I've been forced to do.
Like traditional treatments, alternative therapies seem to help some people with SFIDS, but not everyone. Only one drug has been tested on an experimental basis. That drug is Ampligen, an immune-modulating antiviral drug patented by Hem Pharmaceutical.
We tried it out of the clear blue sky back in 1987 on the first patient, who was my absolutely most severely affected patient, who couldn't even walk down the hallway and had to be carried in on a stretcher for her infusions.
Well, you found me with not a stitch on, totally out on the floor in the bathroom, and then as I came to, I had a seizure. But I remember coming to about 15 or 20 minutes later, and Gloria was on the phone saying, Reed, I think we're going to lose this one. Don't try to get the drug for me. I'll wait till later, but if we don't get it for Nancy, there won't be any Nancy. And I remember laying there thinking, oh my God, do you think there may be a chance that I may live?
About 2 weeks into her therapy, she started walking, and I couldn't believe it. I thought, this is bizarre, you know. A miracle has happened, or else there's something in this drug, one of the two.
I have been on the Ampligen for almost 2 years, and my health is so restored compared to what it was that it's amazing. It's a miracle.
Ampligen has just changed my life. I'm now my very last psychometric. I use both hands together. I can count 10 numbers backwards. I still have problems. I'm not cured, but life is better.
Despite promising results, the FDA did not approve Ampligen for treatment of SFIDS, and Hem terminated its Ampligen trials. Without Ampligen, most patients deteriorated rapidly. Many became completely disabled. Some lost hope. Several committed suicide. With an effective treatment for their illness apparently available but unobtainable, all felt cheated by him, the FDA, and the healthcare system.
I was in the 502 study. It was a 50-50 chance. I knew either I had the opportunity to receive the drug or placebo. Unfortunately, I shot up toilet water twice a week.
The consent form read that at the end of this trial that those who were on Ampligen would be retained. Those who were not on Ampligen would be switched over. It's now been well over a year and several months, and those patients are still not on Ampligen.
But I was under the impression that if I, you know, joined this study, gave them my body, heart, soul, and mind for a solid year so they could do whatever they wanted with it, then I would be guaranteed this drug for a lifetime.
There simply is a limit to what we can do and reach our primary mission for which we have shareholders. We get in any month 1,000 to 3,000 phone calls. We receive many calls from senators, congressmen, etc. We have no way to deal with the tens of thousands of letters and requests that we've gotten.
The whole problem in Ampligen, this legal issue, is this conflict between the individual's right to be treated and then the scientific issues involved that must be addressed before this drug is released to literally anyone. It's like the military. In the military, individuals are sacrificed for the greater good of the whole.
What does it take to get a drug approved? Lots of money. And the ability to influence people, both sides of the law. The difficulty is we don't have the money to spend on the attorneys and the clerks and all the things that are necessary in order to get it through the Food and Drug Administration. So we don't have the money to invest in the politics, basically.
We've had a problem with the FDA that I think is not so much a problem with the FDA as the NIH and the CDC. How can the FDA approve drugs for illness that the other government agencies basically don't take seriously? If they don't say this is a serious disease which for which medications are necessary, the FDA sort of can't go out on a limb and approve a drug that may have some side effects.
This is the nectar of the gods that we're all waiting for. And we don't know if it works for all people, but I think we're entitled to a chance. You know, don't we have a right to life?
So what kind of future awaits people with SFIDS?
If you took 100 people who got chronic fatigue syndrome today, what would happen a year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now? People don't really know, but a rough guess would be about, you know, a third improve, a third are stable, and a third are worse.
But this is really just a guess. The disease is unpredictable. We've come a long way since pioneering doctors Paul Cheney and Dan Peterson were called quacks for treating the yuppie flu.
There's been some real change of mind that we have seen in physicians who were adamantly felt this was not a real disease. And finally see a patient, it's like they see the light and they get completely alters their view. And it comes very quickly when it comes. I mean, it doesn't come, and then it comes. And then they drop down all of these blinders that they've had on and all these preconceived ideas and biases. They simply drop it, and for the first time ever, they begin to look at this with sort of an open mind. And when they do that, this disease comes pouring in.
SFIDS continues to be a mystery disease. But what is known is that millions of Americans languish in its grip. They are sick and need help.
The message I would like to get across to my colleagues who may or may not be used to treating SFIDS patients is to keep an open mind. Keep an open mind about what your patients are telling you. Keep an open mind about the diagnosis and other diagnoses. And keep an open mind about educational material that I hope will be available soon regarding how to deal with these patients, how to treat them, diagnose them, etc. And I suspect that the research is going to be showing significant improvement in diagnosis over the next 2 years.
Good. Okay.
If you're a doctor in practice, as I am, and you see people who clearly are suffering, not yet clear what they're suffering from, but they're suffering. And many people, including some other doctors, have dismissed them and dismissed their illness. It's a sad thing to see.
You're just a doctor, you're all right.
And if you can try to do something about it to better understand why they're sick and hopefully to try to make them better, it's a great challenge. It is the central challenge of any one of us who's a doctor.